Hello, this is week 7. The title is Post versus Git, but it truly is the first full cycle of a PHP where we're doing generating PHP. Then that is calling another dynamically generated PHP program. But in it, you'll get to see the difference between Post and Git. My name is Charles W. Bill Marshall. That's my email address and cell phone number. This is for CIT 253, a 3-credit-hour course titled Data-Driven Web Pages. As always, Blackboard's the official site of assignments and to turn in assignments, but there is supplemental information on cwmclass.com. All right, so what are our goals for this week? Use PHP to generate a web page that allows users to input data on a client. Move data from client to server. Sanitize data arriving on the server. Use PHP to generate a web page appropriate for the data it received. And display the complete web page on the client. And I highlighted complete because you have something in your mind about what you think is going to happen. But to be complete, you have to have thought through all the things that can happen and make sure that your page and your system is well behaved in all conditions. Number one topic, use PHP to generate a web page that allows users to input data on the client. My experience is that I always write a sample or a template or whatever, but I try to make sure I can get the HTML code to work when all I'm doing is worrying about the code first, then I try to write PHP that can generate that. There's enough slip in the getup on HTML, at least in my case, that I want to make sure I know the right answer before I try to create it with PHP. And I will tell you the truth, in any programming I'm doing, I first try to understand how I would do it by hand, then I use a computer to automate it. But my experience has been when you try to automate something that you don't have a pattern or a known solution manually to work, you waste a lot of time and not good things happen. So what is this? Well, we've got the body. We've got a heading one, a paragraph, just some salutation sort of stuff. But here's where we open up a form. And when that form fires, it's going to call stateContact_page.php on our server. We're telling it that we have a label for state, and it says choose a state, and that's a label. So that's just something in the form. Then we're saying that we have a select ID state_, and the name is going to be state. The option value is KY is the value and Kentucky is the displayed. There's the end of the option. And then the second one is Ohio and the end of the option. End of the select, the fact that it is an input type submit, and then the end of the form and the end of the body. And when we put that into our Notepad Plus on our Windows machine, it looks like so. And when we run it, it looks like this. So we have a manual set of code that'll do what we want. Well, except that we have to manually enter the states. But if we want to see the code and we're in Chrome, you come up here and hit these three dots, which brings you down a menu. Gets you to the More Tools option, which you click, and it gets you to Developer Tools, and then you get this display over here, which will help you immensely going forward. We don't need to do much with it here, but just wanted to let you see, while we have a simple, known working program, how you can get into it to see what the browser is seeing. Because the fact that you think you sent something out doesn't mean that that's what PHP really generated. And when you expand the code out, you can see this. You could also see it if you go under sources. And so that looks just like what we typed in over on our web page. But this is in fact what the web server dished out to the browser. All right, and as expected, when we hit the submit button, we had a localhost state contact page PHP, which is what we said we were going to call. And we said the value was going to be state, and we're sent in Kentucky. And it wasn't found because we haven't written the code yet. And so when we pushed the connect button, or the submit button, we found out that it didn't. There's no page out there, state contact underscore page.php, but we can see where we're moving the data in the URL. And so here's the PHP version that generated that code. This is just exactly like what we had in the manual code until we get to here. And so we're opening up the data server like we saw last week. We're creating a connection, which is just like we did last week. We're testing to make sure we got a good connection, just like we did last week. We're selecting the state code and the state name from state demo. And we're saying if the result's greater than zero, good. Then we're going to submit, going into a while loop. And we've got this line we'll come back and talk about, and if not, we got zero results. And then we're out the end of the form, which was manual code, and so forth. So the real action is this line right here. And that line is going to replace this line of the manual code. So let's see how we do what we're doing. Well, the first thing we need is something that doesn't change over time in the manual code. So we just use a single quote, option value, double quote, single quote. Now, why did we use a single quote? Well, the HTML needs double quotes. So the PHP would have been confused if we'd put a double quote here. When it got here, it would have thought, oh, well, I've got the end of that double quote, and it would have broken. By using single quotes, we can treat this double quote as just a string and get this part of the code that we need. So the next thing we need is to fill in the state name, which we use a dot to concatenate because we're getting ready to put another value on our string that we're getting ready to echo. And it's dollar row because our cursor that we opened we called row. And we're picking up the value of state code and a dot to concatenate. Now, we need a double quote and a greater than or a less than symbol here. And so we've got a single quote, double quote, greater than, single quote, a period to concatenate. Now we need the name of the state. So we just go back to dollar row, double quote because we're in single quotes, so it's just a character, state name, the name of the field we want, double quote, square bracket, and then a dot to concatenate the next. And we need to end the line with an option, so we put a single quote, close the option out, single quote, and so I guess we're done. But no, we're not. We still need an apostrophe to make the end of this PHP code. So this is one of the first times when you're writing HTML code with PHP. So you have to think, get your head wrapped around, it's like playing two-dimensional chess or something. These commands are at the server level, but your thing you're generating like this is going to be used at the client level, and you have to keep your syntax right for both places. All right. when we hit localhost program one data, we see choose a state. And when we pull down the selector, we have what we wanted. And in fact, if we added another state to our state table, we'd have five selections. Looks like we're doing pretty good. All right, what did Chrome see? Chrome saw what we hoped it would see if we typed it in by hand. And note that the states are ordered in alphabetical order by the state code, because we didn't give an order by of any other thing. And so that's the primary key. And so it's not surprising that that's how it ordered it. Note that the selector ID is state underscore. I'd really like it to be state underscore code. Well, I've got to go back to the source code of the PHP and change that select ID to be state underscore code to affect that. And there's no reason it had to be that. I just took a while here and decided I wanted to demonstrate to you how you could change something, and so that's what I picked. We have a problem though. If the customer doesn't pick anything, they're going to hear from Indiana. I don't think that's very, you know, listing customers is probably all right, but there's a lot of times that if a selection is not made, you don't want to give a default value. So to solve that, we're going to add this line to the source code of the PHP and add a constant value, option value, note the null, no selection yet, option. So that's the default value. That's what the code looks like after it's generated and we're looking at it on the browser end. Now, the next thing we said we wanted to do was move data from the client to the server. Well, we can see, even though we didn't pick a state, that here's the URL, and lo and behold, we're moving data. So we want to move data from the client to the server. So let's start writing the PHP code on the far end. Well, first we see we are moving data. And if we have this simple HTML program, I'm sorry, this simple PHP program be state contact page.php version 1. So we've got a body that ends here, and all we're going to have is a paragraph that says you asked for state, start a PHP and echo the value, get the value that came in the state variable, in that and in the paragraph. And when we run it, it says, yeah, there's state, and you asked for the state of Kentucky. So we're passing data to the server. If no date is selected, we get a null. So it's still doing what we want it to. But we want to sanitize the data arriving at the server. So the first thing I want to do is get that data out of the URL so that it's less likely for people to see data that I don't want them to. So all I have to do is on the form action, before I get to the end bracket, put in a method equals post. That simply gets the URL to not have data in it. But my program's broken. And it's because I now need to change that line that we had in it to not get, but post state. When we make that change, the URL's out, and we have you ask for Indiana. Now I've got some other stuff left here that we really don't need, but the point I was trying to make is right now that I could get the URL out clean of data and still move the data. Okay, now we want to list the contacts of that state. And we want to respond with a state name, not a code. We don't want to say IN, we want to say Indiana. Well, here's the code that does that. And this is where we're opening the database, just like we normally have been doing. And, well, first thing we're doing is sanitizing the data. We're going to take state, but before we put it into state ID, we're going to use this real escape string and take the value and clean all the bad actors out of it. Then we're going to check the connection, and if we get a connection, we're going to select the state name from state demo, where the state code equals state ID. And note the dots where we're concatenating, because we're building a string here. We're seeing a result of the selection. If we get more than one row, we're really only ever going to get one row in this case, but we still got the while because I was too lazy to take it out. We're going to echo the state name. So all this was on the back of, we're on a line that said you ask for a state, and we're going to fill in the name here. And out the back. And so there is the program. We're making progress. We want to use PHP to generate a web page appropriate for the data received. All right, same program we had before, but after we got the state name in, we then do a select on name first, name last, and city from contact, where the state equals the state ID, which is the same state ID that we were using up here, which has already been sanitized. And let's talk a little bit about why does it need to be sanitized. You know what you're going to send in. It needs to be sanitized because our program responds to somebody yells its name on its port of its IP address, it's going to respond. And there's no way you can know that it wasn't a bad actor who wrote a web page that sends the request constructed the way he wants to. So you cannot depend on anything coming in being anything other than malicious. So you have to make sure all numbers are integers or reals to get the strings, at the SQL injection out that way. And you have to go through all the strings that you're coming through and put them through a real escape string function to clean them up. But we've done that now. And so we're selecting the name on state ID. And if the result is greater than zero, we're going to echo table style width, first name, and so forth. We're making a table. And once again, I can assure you, I had done this in just hand-coded HTML before I tried to do the PHP. And now we're going to get into a while row 2, do a fetch, then we're going to do a table row, table detail, row 2, first name, into that table detail, start another table detail, concatenated to row 2's name last, concatenated to in the table detail with another table detail dot row 2 city and table detail table row. So, and then we're going to echo through every fetch we do. We're in this while we're going to put out a row, and at the end of that while we're going to end the table and center the table in the center table. If we didn't find anybody, we were going to have said which with It should have been with instead of which, no contacts. And if we didn't find a state, we would have said no state has that code. Notice how I'm trying to protect myself so that no matter what kind of bad actors come at me, I have the case handled. The thing that breaks software is not the 80% of the time. It's the other 20 or 10% that you don't think about. And so you need to be sure you've thought of all possible solutions or all possible inputs and have an appropriate outcome for them. The other thing I'm going to do is add this at the bottom as a hard-coded and say it's a link back to our first page. So we've got a way what to do after, you know, you ask for the contacts in Indiana and it tells you. I don't want them to have to do a black button. I want it to be obvious on the page what their next action should be. All right, so let's see what our work looks like. Well, when we first call the page up, we have that. And if we run that, we get a no contact, no state has that code. But if we pick Ohio and run it, we find out that Donald Duck and Daisy Duck live in Aberdeen, Ohio. And we have a link that'll take us back to the front to start over again. Now let's talk about your assignments. I want you to list all the states in the state table on a page, just like we did, and make it a selector. And then when the user selects one of those state values, I want all the contacts in that state's first name, last name, and email address. So it's a slight variation on what we just went through. In addition, I want you to write two more PHP pages that display a selector of all unique last names in the contact table. When the user selects one state on that page, display all the first name cities of contacts with that last name. So, in our example, if the person had picked Duck on the first page, you would have been Daisy and Aberdeen would have been what they would have seen on the second page. And again, I want that page to have a link that'll take me back to the first page. Next week we start jQuery. It's another client-side tool. There's a link to it. You can get a head start by looking that over. It's a tutorial. And again, don't memorize, just learn concepts. So that's week 7 discussion for CIT 253, 3 credit hours, data-driven web pages. I hope it was clear, and if not, I hope you will help me make it clear by calling me during office hours or writing an email and telling me a time I should contact you. We can do a Microsoft team meeting. We can talk on the telephone. I still have a GoToMeeting, but I'm using it less and less and going more and more to team. But I'm here to try to help you learn. Thank you for your time.